projects that are related to TN and things that we are reimbursed through this project. So this is not, this is, there's some reimbursement here to this $500,000.
Community development, there is a position that is added over at the courthouse when that is reopened. And that will be someone who can provide administrative assistance for both the public information officer and community development, and also help coordinate events that are going on at the courthouse, whether those are our events or public events, and just trying to coordinate those things.
We will also provide a staff member in this courthouse through the day.
Yeah, the primary purpose, I don't want you all to think that we're getting full scale into the event business, we're not. But someone's got to be there all day whenever Rachel and Megan are out and about. Also, the two of them are busy to the extent that administratively they need some support. And so this is a good way for us to do that from a cost effective standpoint. They can share because there's a lot of overlap between what they do. But this will keep someone in that building during regular business hours.
Is that job currently posted or will it be?
It will be soon if it's not already.
And the title is?
I'll have to check with Kevin to see. I think it's just administrative support. Maybe you remember what we titled it.
I think it's, we said marketing and facilities.
Yeah, marketing and facilities coordinator.
County clerk has an increase that there's funds in there for the compensation. County manager has a slight increase. Those are some of the projects and things that are going on. Board elections, there's an increase in there. There are three elections scheduled in the coming year. One of those will be a municipal election, so there will be reimbursement on those. There was a request in here for three additional early voting sites, but those are not included. A little bit of increase in finance, just some of the adjustments we did to departmental last year. Human resources, that's up a little bit because of the property casualty insurance premium. ATS projects, that's $634,000 is shown there. That's part of the $986,000 in one time. ATS, really not a touch of a change in there.
There was some additional personnel that was requested, and ITS is not included in this budget.
Public information, that is the other half of that position, which 2018, Leila Ellis, we're gonna move part of that auxiliary into here because the only thing that's in Leila Ellis proper right now are, at this point, is gonna be probation, so we can move all that together. HR building, about $142,000 there. That's another one of those one-time items that's included in $987,000. That is an elevator that we need to replace. 5 years ago, we replaced an elevator for about $85,000. Page 19, the old admin building, really not much of a change there. 4-H camp, this has some of those one-time items in there. There's a lot of tile work and a lot of painting and then rebuilding the seawall that needs to be done this year. So that's part of that capital investment. Reduction in the Board of Elections, and that again, is mainly due to energy costs. On page 20, the Civic Center, there's a little bit of increase there as far as electricity goes, and we're looking into exactly what's going on there. And then the governmental building, again, some energy savings there. Page 21 is this building. Again, we have some energy savings there. And if you see the bond principal and bond interest, this will be the last or next to last bond payment on this building. On page 22, the engineering department increase there is there was a position that was in the NPDES that is moved into engineering, and then another position that's added in there to get Chad's staff back up to where he needs to be. So you'll see a decrease on page 23 to the NPDES for that. And then, as I said earlier, we increased the amount that's in contingency just based on some things that are going on this year. Page 24, Superior Court. The increases that you see under the salaries and benefits have to do with there were 5 retirement payments that were coming out of court costs. Those have been moved to HR, to payroll, so that they can get 1099-Rs.
And that's the local retirement supplement that we pay to some of the judges, the Superior Court judges. That's not regular employee retirement.
Right. Community corrections, really not much of a change there. Clerk of court, not much of a change. She's really happy with her current staffing and how everything's going. The district attorney requested no increase in his budget. Page 26. State court is virtually the same. Page 27, the solicitor general, there is a part-time position included in there. Page 28, after court, there is some additional money in here as far as
too, before we get too far into the sheriff's budget, he works very hard to try to control costs. You know, our numbers are up criminal justice case-wise, and of course, inflation's hit that department just like all of our departments. Stephanie normally has to go back in and add in some money over his request, because he's really just tries to get his total budget under a particular number, but we know from past experience that just based on consumption, they're not going to be able to live within that line item, so we do work to make sure that they have what they need where that's concerned.
Under the jail, there are some increases in costs, such as the medical, and the feeding. However, whenever we put this budget together, there were currently 35 vacant positions in there, so we did not remove the positions, but we didn't fund them. I think we did not fund 25 out of 35. And that's just, you know, based on historical, there's no way that those 20 or 25 vacant positions are going to stay filled all the time.
If he can fill them, we have money in contingency to cover it. So we hope that eventually he can get staff covered.
Animal services, the shelter, there are some increases here. As far as personnel goes, there is a rescue coordinator position, and then there's some part-time attendants that are remade full-time. And part of this is in anticipation of a new shelter and being staffed up and ready for that. Over on the enforcement side, there is some capital equipment in here, the $40,000, that is for a chassis or a box for the vehicles. Some of the boxes they have are basically just falling apart. So that's out of that one time money. Emergency management, basically no change in that. There was some cost in last year for some replacements of some items that we've gotten taken care of. Some of those things have gone away. There's an increase for emergency medical services. Their request for rolling stock was actually $250, but they said a new ambulance is running about $240, so we adjusted it by that $10,000. On page 39, really not much of a change there. Page 40, Public Works Administration. There were some items that are one time that are in there. Page 41, grading. You'll see at the bottom here that that nets out zero because all of grading is part of the last year that we didn't fund. slight decrease. So, again, the net for the general fund is that $987,000, which are those one-time costs.
And back to the Board of Equalization, we reached out to Ben's office to find out what their current rate is per day. But we think that before we have our final hearing, we'll come back to you all with a slight recommendation for, a recommendation for slight increase in Board of Equalization. I think it's probably been 10 years or more since they have.
Yeah, they've been asking the last 3 years or so for an increase.
Okay, well, Stephanie's ahead of me. So they are, their per diem currently is $65 per day.
So, something to think about.
Okay. On page 47, we have the commissary fund. Some of these revenues are down this year. So we have adjusted on the expenditure side to try to keep that in the black. And our seizures there, on page 49, are there for information, as well as on page 50, the law library. Page 51 is your hotel motel or accommodation tax, and those are showing increases. So the way those will trickle out is tourism will get 3/7, recreation gets 1/7, and the transfer to the special services fund is 3/7. Page 52, you have your grants. Those all zero out. The only real change in anything there is the DUI grant had an additional, position in there that is 100% grant funded. On page 57, the jail operations, again, we have some drops in some of these funds. But we have adjusted some things and made sure that this fund is still in the black. Page 58, drug abuse treatment. The decline in some of those revenues. Because of that, we have the grant matches for the accountability courts on there. So on page 59, you'll see that we have put in a reduction in funding for like that. Page 60 is the emergency communications fund. The vast majority of those items under intergovernmental are for the public safety radio system, and those will total up to the amount of that public safety radio system budget, which is on page 63. The last item under intergovernmental, the other government 911 charges, and the remainder of the revenues except for rent are what cover the rest of the emergency communications fund, which is going to be your facilities maintenance, your transfers, and your 911 operations. And again, because of the number of vacancies in that department, on page 62, there are currently between telecommunication specialists and telecommunication operators, there are currently 10 positions vacant. And there was a new position requested. So we have not funded 6 of those positions for the new position, or the new position in this budget.
Yes.
It was for a call.
Part of the challenge that we're having there is, and part of it, this is a probably bigger conversation for maybe our November meeting, but the non-emergency use of 911, so keep in mind that the emergency use of 911 is when someone calls 911, a citizen calls 911, or if public safety for an emergency purpose. But right now, there is a tremendous amount of activity that is going on with some of the smaller law enforcement agencies, with the amount of traffic stops and what those smaller cities are looking at as far as revenue goes. And there are too many of them, and we're working on this, that instead of using their in-car computers or just calling 911 to run tags and ask questions and do things that they might else have resources in their vehicle for. So we're going to have some conversations there. But some centers have separate call takers and separate dispatchers, because not everyone can listen to what's going on and what people are calling in for in one ear and be able to click over and dispatch it out of the other ear. And so it's not so bad whenever you're working for a center that's not taking as many calls as we are, but whenever you're as busy as we are, it can get to be a challenge, and they're burning out really fast. And it's harder to find employees that can multitask to that extent. So that will be an ongoing discussion, but before we start adding and start looking at splitting up call takers and dispatchers, we really have a conversation with our users of the system to see if there's some efficiencies that they can look at on their side that will help first. And then whenever we bottom that out, then we can look at what we might need to do position-wise.
So primarily we're talking about pay hire agreements and
yes. And two of those primarily.
Right.
Because the sheriff's office is handling Lake Park after 5 or 6 o'clock at night.
Yeah, during the day they still have their patrol call.
Has Lake Park an officer? Lake Park has a police officer.
They operate from, like, I'm going to say, like 8 to 5. Their work day, and then the sheriff takes over the night time.
Is that include Dasher with that?
They're in Dasher all the time.
Yeah.
They take their Dasher. Sheriff's office takes Dasher, takes their Dasher.
Yeah, I know they pay us to do that.
Yeah. But they don't have anybody there using the radio system right now.
All right, over on page 65, do some with this. Again, the decrease in some of these revenues. Over on page 66, the VA, the general fund request, he says, will always, I mean, he doesn't ask for an increase or a decrease as long as this number here doesn't decrease. However, the solicitor, the witness, always has an increase there, and this is going to happen. We're going to have a conversation about this eventually, because this is going to start eating up. On page 67, the special services fund. Again, there's increase in the insurance premium. And we divide this between this department and the fire department. There's potentially more revenue going into the fire department based on the assessments and where those eventually come out unless we adjust that mill rate. So we put a little bit of the excess of the insurance premium in this fund, because we don't want to completely deplete the fund balance in this fund, because it has still been used to fund some construction for the fire department. There's a little bit of increase in alcohol and beverage licenses. All that will be based on some of the volume. Overall, those revenues in this department are about 17.35%. And the one right below that. Over on page 68, for expenditure-wise, there's really no change in what we had in our contingency for the regional commission, a little bit of increase in the regional commission dues. Over on page 70, project at this time, this would be something you would have to approve.
And most of it is traffic study related, related to growth corridors and helping plan to the house.
So then on page 73, we'll see where zoning has been added back into the budget. Page 74, the fire department. Based on where we are, estimated a property tax, again, until we see a digest and see what incorporated is, we don't really know what that's going to be. Also, there was a question about, we're currently providing fire protection in Dacher, and there was a question of whether or not, we would do that in Lake Park as well. Currently, Dacher is just paying us a flat fee for that, but if we're charging the incorporated residents a millage, in all fairness, we should do the same thing if we're doing it for those other cities. So based on what the current digests are, or 2022 digests, you're looking at probably $38,000 or so for Dacher, compared to the $15,000 we're currently getting. And if you added Lake Park to that, it would be about $79,000.
And of course, that, as everybody else would pull their tax bill, it wouldn't be something that the city of Lake Park and old Dacher would have to pay.
Correct.
Individual property.
Lake Park by itself is how much?
Lake Park is $79,000.
And we don't know yet if Lake Park is going to be an option. Periodically, we get calls, and I think some of you may have conversations as well related to the future and what Lake Park considerations for their fire department might be. So we just wanted to have your blessing to be prepared to have that type of conversation if we were approached.
And again, those numbers are based off of what their 2022 digest numbers were.
There are some very positive ISO impacts for the south end of the county if we were to take in Lake Park. There's some of that area around the lakes and stuff down there that currently is outlier that would be improved and picked up if we were to do that.
Well, don't you just keep in mind also, Lake Park basically in the past, I don't know if they currently have a fire chief, but in the past, they have a fire chief and they work with volunteers. So with the discussions that we're having as we move forward with a fire station in the Twin Lakes Lake Park area, it would really make a lot of sense at that point for us to service all of that area down there, Lake Park proper, as well as the south end of the county. And then the folks can just pay a village. It really, I think the city of Lake Park, they would be receptive to it, just simply because they wouldn't have to deal with fire.
The biggest problem they're going to have is losing the service. They're going to lose the fire service.
I'm sorry?
They're going to lose, they won't lose one of their services on their list of services they provide. They're going to lose fire service as a provided service.
So I talked to Walter about that, and he said that there's a possibility, and I've not asked him to research this yet because I wanted to wait till we had some real direction from you all on it. But I think there could still be a contractual relationship between the county and Lake Park, even though we would charge it the way that we charge it, that would still help them check that box. I think there's a way around that.
Okay. Are we thinking long range, fully manned fire station, Twin Lakes area?
Yes.
Isn't that mighty close to Clydeville?
It is, but right now Clydeville's running 2-1, the call that every other station we have is running, and a lot of that is because of the interstate and that Lake Park area. So it would have a significant impact on ISO and also our response times. The two plans that we have, the next recommendation for station would be Lake Park, and then the one following that would be something on the west side of the interstate. And I feel like once we get those two completed, we should be good for the next 20 or 30 years.
On page 75, you have the facilities maintenance for fire stations that has increased, but as we bring these other stations online, which have occurred during this year, those costs are going to increase. Under fire services, there's an increase showing in some of the salaries and benefits. That is because we adjusted those volunteers, and they've been, are moved into part-time positions, and that can help address some of the staffing issues and some of the overtime issues that we have. There were some requests to have some additional positions, but they were not included. Overall, fire services has a 10% increase. And as those other stations come online and some of the operations and then some of the things that they're having to add some costs to as far as ISO, there's some things that they needed to purchase. Some of that is one time.
Related to the transition as well, as far as volunteers go, what Stephanie's referring to there was we had about $177,000 in training pay for volunteers that we have funded for years. Having volunteers on the roster and not having them show up at calls hurts us where ISO is concerned. So it was a better move to take those volunteer positions and make them part-time employee positions. Whenever we talk about managing overtime, you know, the fire department has a Kelly Day process that is based off of how many hours they actually work in a month because they're at the fire department for a 24-hour period. So having these part-time positions come in, they can't work more than 29 hours a week, and they would alleviate some of the overtime that is created whenever people have the Kelly. And it gives us a labor pool of folks that we know whether or not we would want to bring them on full-time moving forward as we have turnover and need to refill those positions. But we can fund 10 part-time firefighter positions at the same rate that we were paying volunteers for training pay. And so that was the amount that we backed into, and there's 10 positions there.
This will do away with volunteers.
So we will have, I think we've got three left. The challenge that we had there was we have three county employees that have been active volunteers. Casey Russell, 911, has probably been a volunteer firefighter for the last 25 years or so. And he does work. And he's also, at one point, I'm not sure if he still is, but he was the interim fire chief in Dayhara. Then we have two employees at Public Works. Because we can't have someone on our payroll as a part-time person and a full-time person, we've allowed those three to maintain volunteers as long as they keep up their hours and they're answering calls. But we will not allow any additional full-time employees to become volunteers in the future. That was a way to phase out those three and be fair to them in the process.
Then on the bottom of page 76, you'll see a big item here for a maintenance shop for fire services. And what we did is split the maintenance cost, and this is on fire trucks, not SUVs or pickup trucks that are in the fire department. These are actual fire trucks. And that just separates out those maintenance costs. Those are handled at a shop in Naylor. It's all still managed by Robin, or the accounting side of it, and making sure the purchases and inventory are taken care of. But those mechanics are at the shop in Naylor, and they're doing the maintenance on the fire trucks.
Keeping in mind, the purpose of that, as much as anything, is the fact that fire trucks are a whole different animal than most any other vehicle. They require different types of fluid, different types of seals, different everything, different
training certification,
and as well as training certification for the mechanics they have to work on. So it just makes sense to have a facility where they would be able to work and just concentrate strictly on fire trucks.
And we're pretty proud of this. In the last year, we were with our firefighters and with those driver operators to make sure that they're taking care of those trucks, because there's not spare trucks. We don't have spare trucks, there's not spare trucks to be found, parts are very hard to get. Stephanie mentioned earlier, I think, that we have delay in the fire trucks that we have already ordered and paid for, because they're nearly built, but there's some switches and things like that, but there's just a supply chain issue over that are taking us a little longer to get there. So our folks are being very careful on the road to make sure that we don't ding anything or tear anything up.
Page 78 and 79, that is just plus 8. Again, those tax revenues are increasing. Page 80 is your T-SPLOST. Again, those numbers are increasing. And again, this is where our dirt road maintenance will come from. Then you have your LVAG, which is actually down a little bit. Page 81 is information only. Page 82 is the water sewer. The credit card fees, there's a revenue and an expense for credit card fees. That is what we're charging people, the convenience fee for credit cards and what we're having to pay the credit card companies. We will only be on that system for the first 5 months of 2024. Then we will be with the new software, and that will be handled completely differently, and it will be completely handled by the payment processor. So we reduced those amounts. We did put in an increase there for water and sewer, but tried to be conservative on that, because we don't know once those meters get changed out, that software gets changed out, and with all the expansion that we have, what those revenues are actually going to come in at. Over on page 83, you have your facilities maintenance for water sewer. This is not maintenance on any part of the water sewer system. This is for the different offices that are outside of this building. Water sewer operations, this is all the county operations. There are some additional positions in there. There's some facility service workers. There was a project manager added during the year. Over on page 84, you'll see overall that's an 8.74% increase. On page 85, with water sewer for a duty, a little bit of an increase there, 7.69%. On page 87, landfill fund, those host fees are up slightly. Under the landfill, there's a 22% increase again. There's some maintenance and some improvements that need to be done at the landfill. And this is the closed landfill. The revenues come from the existing landfill on 84, but these expenditures for the landfill are for our closed landfill.
What is the host fee? Is it the same per ton? Which is, what you were talking
about? $2. I think it's $2.
Two?
I think it's $2.
There's a ceiling on it, though.
I've also asked for some competitive pricing. Our mowing contract, we have to keep it mowed. Our mowing contract went up, and the same provider's been doing it for quite a while. That's not something we can do in-house because the slope is pretty specialized. So, again, we've asked for some pricing there to see if make sure we're in the market.
On page 88 is the water program.
On the water.
That's right. That's our program.
We
try all the things, and then we can reset it before we lock it in finally. They will also, though, need to go in and create an account, and we will start a program to help them through that process, and now we'll be able to start creating those accounts in the next couple of weeks, and those will not wash off whenever we reset the training side of the system. So all of that seems to be going very smoothly. I feel like we're probably over communicating a little more than we're leaving things out, but we're going to continue to make that community comfortable with what we're doing until they tell us they've had enough, and then we'll know what we can do.
And also, I have sent a letter to the city about us to notify them that we will be officially taking over inspections for the unincorporated area as a juvenile.
Page 92, quiet time. So on the revenue side, we've probably been conservative on this. This is kind of based off of what our experience is so far. And, you know, I think we all hope that as we get it more out into the community, it starts to grow, and we'll do better than this during the year, but we wanted to be conservative since this is the first year. And then on the expenditure side, these are the current positions that are in there. We have a split up between the food and beverage services, the pro shop, and then the actual golf course expenditure-wise. We have some of the positions in here. We have what we think we're going to use operationally. There may be, you know, some other things that we need to do, but this is kind of a rough budget for the first year. And where we hope to end up. Okay, page 95, equipment maintenance. There's an increase there in the rental fees. That's what's coming from the other departments. That's based again on the cost of maintaining as well as the age and condition and the number of vehicles and equipment in the fleet. But that still should remain in the black region. Health insurance, page 98. A little bit of increase for employees that are participating and what we're fitting in as far as number of positions, which should cover, for the most part, the expenditures, but we do have a decent fund balance in here, so we should be fine in that department. Workers' compensation, again, because of the number of positions and the COLA merits, et cetera, we'll have an increase in the revenue there. I did drop the expenditure now back to the 2023 level. But that's because we have some higher than normal in the current year that we're paying out on. And so it should kind of level back out. And then the technology fund, again, this is based on some additional contracts that will be in this year because of the transition with the water sewer software and the addition of the inspection software.
Thank you, ma'am. Any questions? Concerns? Stephanie, again, please forward our appreciation for serving you and your staff for the great work that y'all always do on trying to put this budget together and praying about it. Thank you. Certainly for you and your leadership and your staff to be able to get us to this point. Again, keep in mind this is a draft form. So any adjustments that you may just deem that needs to be made or any other discussions, then please let us know. We'll see what we can do.
You want to give them the rest of the calendar for them right now?
That's what I'm about to do. So, you know, we have to back into some of this because of average that there's any adjustments that we need to make.
I just wanted to remind him, the 20th is the meeting, not the, the public hearing. Any other questions? Thank y'all. Appreciate it.
Gretchen, how's that?